We have a new sponsor today, Casper Mattress. You can purchase a Casper mattress at casper.com/Feldman or by using the promo code Feldman. And now, on to the show. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman. On today's show, from the movie Blood Ransom and the hit sitcom Two Broke Girls, Kevin Meaney. You've seen him on Letterman, The Tonight Show, Regis, HBO. He is, well, Kevin Meaney. Kevin Meaney for the hour. Hi, Kevin.
Hi, David. How are you tonight?
Very good. Where are we talking to you tonight?
Where are we talking? Where am I?
Yeah, where are you?
I'm at home in Forestburg, New York.
Oh.
That's right outside of Cahoonsie. Not far from Squirrel Corners. Fowlerville?
Doesn't ring a bell.
Okay. About 2 hours outside of New York City.
Help me a little more. New York.
Going towards Binghamton.
New York City. Doesn't Binghamton.
World no. Trade Center. 9/11.
Never happened.
Okay.
I don't have a sense of humor about 9/11 because my first wife was in the South Tower that day.
Oh God.
And she survived.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Worse.
Yeah, I sneaking little bits from my act into a conversation with Kevin Meaney.
That is just
the height of cowardice, I believe.
Yeah.
So where are you playing?
To be honest, I have a story about this. I'm not going to say the guy's name, but there was a couple that I knew lived in New York. He was a big executive. He worked downtown. Was at the Twin Towers when they came down, and his wife wanted to get out of the relationship. She just couldn't take it anymore. They had three kids, beautiful family, but he was a raging lunatic alcoholic cross-dresser, okay? And would get totally smashed and dress up in women's clothing, and not that there's anything wrong with that. It's perfectly natural. And go out and get drunk, and a friend of mine who was a policeman would picked him up a few times, drunk and disorderly, nothing, they book him, with a wig on, unshaven, and
I've been there.
Sure. Listen, we've all made mistakes. So he, his wife wanted to get out of the relationship, just, was calling friends, I can't take it. It's getting worse. It's just the, but he makes a good living. He's a big executive. So, she's got a lifestyle. She's, beautiful house in Westchester County, kids in private school. What is she going to do? Hmm. Anyway, the towers come down. He doesn't show up. She figures that he's gone, right? Finished. Oh, God, just calling everybody. He's not home. He's not home. God, what am I going to do? He's not home. What am I going to do? Horrible. Oh, God. Tragic. So tragic. Everything's tragic. Me. Well, who shows up at 3 o'clock in the morning covered in asbestos dust? He shows up. I'm home. I'm home. Oh, God, she wanted to kill him. But now he... they're still married. They worked it out. So many people work it out. That's why you have to give it time. They're back together. He's he drinks non-alcoholic beer. Always smiling, highly medicated.
Pantsuits instead of dresses?
Probably. Yeah, he probably wears the pants. Yeah, that's part of it that no one's ever discussed, is the cross-dressing. You know, that was a drunken mistake. You know, I put on a dress. You know, I don't discuss that.
Marriage is, it's hard to keep a marriage together. It's hard to keep
I celebrated 18 years on October 25th of my anniversary. I'm not married anymore, but we still celebrate.
And you have a child?
I have a child, yes. She's in reform school. upstate New York, not too far from Attica. You know, and that's their chant at school. Attica, Attica. And we had to bring passports to the school. Mm-hmm. I think they're signing them up for ISIS. You know, it's you can't go there unless you call first. I don't like that, you know.
No. Is your daughter funny? Does she have a sense of humor?
Yes. Unfortunately, she is she is funny. Yeah. Talented, funny, tells me if I would have had the training that she's getting, I would be very successful. So if you've only would have taken an acting lesson or read a book, you know, maybe you would be further along in your career.
Does she know that your lack of success is paying for her classes?
I'm not. I gave all that up to the wife. I have nothing to do with the child except support. Just, Marianne makes all the decisions in school, and she gets to pull the plug if she's, dying. I don't have that right. I have, I can't. When you sign the divorce decree, you have to, somebody has to make that decision. And Marianne said, I'll make it, I'll do it. You know, so she's got that, you know. When you do a will, you have to write that stuff out.
Well, do you find that now, no longer having the power to pull the plug on her, you have less control?
It's a different world we live in, David. Parents used to threaten their children with death. If you do that, I'm going to kill you. I will strangle you till you can't breathe. Try saying that to a kid today. You know. Anybody listening, just go up to your kid. I'm going to say, if you don't do your homework, I'm going to strangle you. And you're going to be dead. I'll bury you in the backyard, you piece of crap. Yeah, try that. You will be locked up in 20 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, I remember my father banging on the bathroom door. Get out of here. I thought he was going to kill me. You know, I was never hit. You know, I was threatened all the time that I would be beaten and hit. But it never was. But, you know, that fear, you know, you have that fear, you know, that, you know, you're going to be beaten. You know, I came out of the bathroom cowering and, you know, and just, no, Daddy, don't hit me. Stop it. Don't look at me like that. Don't look at me like that. Daddy, stop it. You know, keep growling. Arr! You know, ready to, what did I do? I did nothing. Well, and that poor kid that was in the, you know, beaten up by that cop, you know, in South Carolina, maybe that girl didn't do anything and said, listen, I'm not getting up. Yeah, you're crazy teacher, you know. You know, I was beaten in school, you know. I was one of the last years of being beaten in school. I think that's when I was in school, you know.
Yeah. Were you traumatized? I mean, who?
Yes. Oh, God, yes. Yeah, totally traumatized. I can't talk about it, but.
You know, I may or may not have been in therapy with one of my children just to, you know, smooth things over, and I may or may not have heard a therapist say something to the effect, you know, in the 70s, mm-hmm. we used to believe that you should share everything with your kid. Tell them everything about your life. Tell them about your marriage, your drug use, your sex, everything. Now we've decided it's okay to keep secrets from your kids. They don't
Have we decided that?
That the new thinking is kids don't need to know everything about you.
I've told my daughter everything, you know, and she I have a record. So, you know, she can Google me and find out that I've been arrested a few times and I've been married to another woman, you know, that I didn't even know. She can, they Google, you know, they bad sets, you have a bad set. So I listened to a YouTube thing the other day of this guy discussing, he saw me three times, like in the 80s, the 90s, and recently, and then said, you know, the last time I saw him, you know, I didn't, he was talking about being gay, and I didn't want to hear that, and I was like, I was just, you know, I'm trying out new stuff, you know, and, you know, he's has a YouTube show. Oh, piece of shit. God damn it. I'm sorry. I shouldn't be. I'm lashing out now.
What happens? Do you think it'll be possible that 20 years from now we'll be sitting down, you and I will get married, we'll adopt a Chinese baby. They'll be much more expensive.
There'll be many more Chinese babies. And the reason why they're doing that, the Chinese can have two babies now per couple, is because they want to come after Donald Trump. You know, they, we need to get Trump. You have two babies. Everyone have two babies. Come after Trump. Get him bad. That is, I guess that's wrong to do that impression. I'm sorry.
We're talking with Mickey Rooney from Breakfast at Tiffany's. No, but
oh, God. By the way, I'm in blackface. Yeah. When April showers, take away flowers with me.
Because, you know, because of you, we used to listen to Al Jolson at the Holy City Zoo. But do you think Chinese babies now that they can have two are going to become more expensive to adopt here in America, because now that they can hold on to their babies and have more of them? Or how does that work? Or is it supply and demand? Did they become cheaper to adopt?
They're going to be cheaper.
Oh, right, right. Yeah.
And they're cheaper now than a white baby. So if you could try to get a white baby, you know, you're paying premium bucks.
Yeah. What about a white baby from China or a black baby? How about a black baby from China?
Black baby in China, black baby in China should stay in China, you know, because they're going to play basketball and they're going to, it's going to be a whole, you know, they're going to do well. They're going to, you know, immediately. You go to China. I've been to China and China. That's how Trump says it. China.
So you were entertaining who in China?
The Prime Minister. I was there with John Hancock Insurance, and I was doing a private show for them. And I said, "Oh my God, I play John Hancock on 30 Rock. I can I can show that clip, you know, before I come up on stage. You know, you're John Hancock, all the big execs." And then I go, I can't play that because I can't air that because, you know, I'm playing John Hancock and Tracy Ullman is yelling at me, you know, in the scene. You're a racist. John Hancock's a racist. He's had slaves. All that crap. Blah, blah, blah. And I'm going, although it's funny in that setting, it wouldn't be funny. It would be, I wouldn't have had a good set after that.
John Hancock had the biggest signature on the Declaration of Independence, right?
Hello.
Now, was he the first one to sign the Declaration of Independence? Because I always thought...
He had the big signature, you know, which is he had more than a big signature, put it that way.
Was he overcompensating for something?
No, it was big. You know, look it up, Google it.
Big signature, big pen.
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah. And that was the pen that they used, you know, with the ink,
a quill pen.
And then 70 years ago today, was the introduction of the ballpoint pen. Did you know that?
No, I did not.
And it cost $12 back in 1947. And today, that would be the equivalent of $120.
Have you ever run out of ink with a ballpoint pen?
Light it on fire. Put it, you know, it doesn't happen much more anymore because, you know, who uses a pen? You're on the computer. But if the pen does run out, you know, put it under a flame, you know, the ballpoint, and just heat it up just for a second, and you'll get some extra ink.
For several years, when I knew you back in San Francisco, you would write your jokes down by scaring a squid who would shoot some kind of inky black liquid that you would write with.
Yes. That was, back then, you could go to Chinatown and get that squid. Today, you know, we're not getting as much squid, or we're getting squid, you know, to Chinatown and to the States without ink.
Yeah.
Because the ink is very valuable, like a tusk.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or a eye of a newt.
You are correct, sir.
Yes, I have an eye of a newt. Yes.
Well, you know, back when we were starting out as comics, you could scare a squid for the ink, and it was perfectly acceptable. Now, it's animal abuse. Earlier, I said, you know.
It still is. Do you know how they get them up to the surface of the ocean?
No.
They shine lights, like those big Hollywood searchlights that you live with every night. There's always a searchlight up there, you know, a new premiere. Blood Ransom, movie I was in, which you can... there's so many of the great movies I've been in. Plump Fiction.
Plump Fiction.
Plump Fiction, yeah. I play the chocolate dealer. But... they shine the lights into the water, into the ocean, you know, the big spotlights for the movie stars, into the ocean, and the light goes down deep, deep, deep into the ocean. The squid comes up to the surface. Then they stab them in the eye and get them, you know, and drain their ink. And next thing you know, you have calamari.
That's why it's always winking at me.
Yeah. Hello, hello.
So... do you think there'll be a time when we'll go back to being able to threaten your kids? We can't do it now, but do you think if we adopt a Chinese baby 20 years from now, it'll be okay to say, practice the piano or I'll kill you?
No. Kids will always, they're going to win. You know, all they have to do is pick up a phone, videotape you, you know, abusing them, you know, mentally.
But I'm saying our psychiatrists or psychologists eventually going to say, you know what, we were wrong. The same way we were wrong about sharing every bit about yourself with your kids.
Yeah.
It turns out we were wrong about not threatening to kill your kids. You should do it. We've done some studies, and kids who are yelled at and threatened thrive.
I think there's a fine line. I think if you know, you have to know how to threaten. You know, you have to know where to stop, you know. You know, like when you're trying to hit them in the back seat of the car, you know, you don't want to really hit them, but you want to scare them,
mm-hmm.
You know, where they're like, you're going to kill me, you know, and you have to shut up, you know, or, you know, whatever the situation is, you know. But today, you know, you swing that arm back there. The kid has a, you know, video device, cell phone. My daughter's had a phone since she was 7. I got her one when we were getting divorced. I said, call me if you need me. Put on your pillow. You know, mommy's crazy. And, you know, I'll save you. You know, so.
I bought my kids a Grass Valley switcher. So I walk around the house and they're going, take one. Ready, two, take two. They're just, that's a very bad attempt at. Do you go out of your, one of the things I've noticed with my kids is I just think annoying them is funny. Like, I live in New York now, and I told them that's when they were younger that it's Houston Street, not Houston Street.
Right.
Or that it's Italian dressing, not Italian. That's yeah. It's not. And then when they were well, eight,
it's not tomato sauce. It's gravy.
But I just got off on my 8 year olds going, the movie theater's on Houston Street, and people would go, "What?
What are you talking about? It's Houston Street. Why would you say something like that?
Is that
who's,
abuse?
Who's your father?" Well, listen, make sure they don't have a New York accent, you know? So that's what everybody in my family has a New York accent, but somehow I didn't want to be associated with my family when I was growing up. I didn't want to sound like them. I got a tape recorder when I was like 13 or 14. I was like, oh my God, I can't sound like this. I have to sound different. So I created a new world.
I don't think of you as a New Yorker. I think of you as a Boston comic, but you're from like upstate New York, right?
I'm from Westchester County.
Is that upstate or West?
No, that's 30 minutes from Manhattan.
But you started in San Francisco, and we just had Barry Crimmins, the star of Call Me Lucky.
Yes.
On the show. It's a great movie that people should go see. It's directed by Bobcat Goldthwait. You and Barry Crimmins, two opposite ends of the comedy spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
You lived together at the Barracks. What were the Barracks? And did you get along with Barry Crimmins?
I always get along with him because I was afraid of him. You know, he's a, you know, more of a, you know, it kind of, you know, if you don't respect him, you know, you'll be beaten. He'll beat you up, you know, with the truth. Mm-hmm. So, but he would let you get away with things. So, you know, he has a big heart also, but yeah, you had to know when not to cross the line. So it was, you know, it was, you know, kind of a parental thing, but I liked him and he gave me work. So, you know, the first thing I did, I liked him because he gave me work. Then I liked him because, you know, I liked, you know, what his thought process was and, you know, how he looked at the world. So, and I felt I didn't feel the same way exactly. I was more of a pussy where I would go, well, you know, maybe they're right. They're not right. You know, you don't know. So, you know, I would compromise myself until, you know, as I get older, I would say, I'm going to tell the truth. I'm going to, you know, be more like Barry. So he was very inspirational in that way, you know, where he would kind of instill that courage in all the comedians that he liked.
What were the Barracks?
That was the Barracks was a house in Cambridge that at one time had been a Harvard dormitory. And how I found that out, I was living in one of the rooms there and the windows had never been cleaned in the house. You know, it was like just this dive of a place that you would just, it was a flop house, you know, like furniture found on the road that would be, you know, put in the living room or in the bedroom and, you know, just dishes that weren't done, you would throw them out. That would be it, you know. The old-time bathtub where you would take a shower and you would have to straddle the tub because the tub would be filled with water because the drain was stuck and you would straddle it and, you know, like a circus act, take a quick shower and then eventually the water would go down. You know? But I was washing the window. I said, I'm going to clean my room. I'm going to make it nice. So I'm washing the windows, and I see all these initials on them that says, you know, 84, 97. And I'm like, wow, what's this? And I researched it before Google, before the internet, before Al Gore. And I found out that it was a dormitory and the students that when they would graduate, they would write their initials and the year they graduated on the window.
Are those 18?
Yes. Yes.
Wow.
So when Lenny lived there, he would be drunk, you know, like crazy lunatic. And I mean, and not just him, everybody there, you know, there was coke parties, playing cards, gambling, you know, girls, everything, you know, you name it. Lenny comes home one night mad, the girlfriend broke up, you know, throwing chairs through the windows. you know, just breaking all the windows of these historic windows that, you know, people spent hours, you know, carving their initials, you know, their initials and the year they graduated, 87. And the windows, you couldn't look through them really because they had weathered. And you know how windows, as they get aged, there's water in there and it, you know, drips down. So it's kind of a foggy look through it, you know, ancient windows. Well, he, you know, broke a lot of them. Not all of them.
How did,
damn it, Carol. I love Carol. She let me. Ah!
What was the sperm room?
That was Barry Nightkrug's room.
And what does that mean, the sperm room?
If Barry wasn't there and somebody would have a girl, you know, to get over there, they could go into the sperm room. And then you have their way with their woman. And there wasn't a door. There was just a sheet that hung down, a light blue sheet. You know, God, I haven't heard the name the sperm room. And I have to Google that.
Barry, actually, I'm playing the sperm.
He's so talented, Barry. And you should ask Barry about the sperm room. He lived in there.
I'm playing the sperm room in Toledo, Ohio next week.
Oh, my God. That's not far from the humor bin.
Now, how many years did you live in the barracks?
Probably, it seemed like, you know, 5 years, but it was probably maybe a year and a half.
And did visiting comics stay there?
Oh, yeah. Everybody stayed there.
All right. So you're a pretty disciplined guy. You are.
Well, you know, that was a different time. You know, it was just, I was just starting out, and all those guys were out in San Francisco. Lenny, Martin Olson, Don Gavin came out there to do the comedy competition, and they go, hey, you look like us. Why don't you come back to Boston and get you a lot of work? You know, so I said, yeah. So I came back, and I worked every night, and Lenny goes, you can stay here, you know, you know, you can sleep on the couch, you know, whatever you want.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I always thought you were, excuse me, I always thought you were a Boston comic.
No.
Who relocated to San Francisco.
No, I grew up in New York, found my way to San Francisco, and then to Boston. And, you know, when I first was on The Tonight Show with Johnny, he goes, next guy, he's found him in Boston. Is that a Boston scene? I don't know. Kind of a weird, different guy. I think you're going to like him.
Boy, did you kill.
It's all on, you know, my website, kevinmeaney.com. All the kids are going there.
So
I have a lot of links up there that you can watch all the comedy from yesteryear.
So you're living in the barracks. Could you make plans? Could you say, boy, I'm tired. I'm going to get a good night's sleep tonight.
No. You would come home and you would, there was always drugs, always booze, always, you know, playing cards. Don Gavin would get together a game of poker and lose all your money. You know, he was like a card shark. You know, he was smarter than anybody. But he would win all the time. You know, I can't lose. I have no money. I've lost everything.
And were you doing sets every night?
Yes. Every night.
Wow.
You know, whatever bar, you know, that would let people come in to do a stand-up show. Like Mike McDonald booked them, Barry booked them, Paul Barkley, Bill Downs, Chance Langton, you know, everybody, Mike McDonald. I have a room on Tuesday. You know,
is it fair to say that the Boston audiences back then, are you undoing your kimono?
No, I'm not doing anything.
I hear Velcro.
Oh, my microphone is rubbing on my shirt collar.
Ah, okay.
My dirty, filthy shirt collar.
It's not touching.
Oh, God, I should clean it. I'm going to scrub it down tonight, hang it out on the line.
Is it fair to say that the Boston audiences were either the worst or the best in America at any given time? You never knew what you were going to... Is that a fair statement?
No, I would say most of the time they're the best. Yes, there are some times when they're not good, you know, whether that's alcohol, you know, related.
Or I've been booked on the show.
I have no idea. But 95% of the time, they're the best audiences in the world. So you can't get people any more, you know, because they love to laugh. When they laugh, they howl, you know. Right. And so, but if they don't like it, they get mad and they can attack you and hurt you, you know. I'll kill you, you piece of crap. Well, look at me.
Today's show is sponsored by Casper. Casper, the online retailer of premium mattresses for a fraction of the price. Casper Mattress is an obsessively engineered mattress at a shockingly fair price. It has just the right sink and just the right bounce. They've combined two technologies, latex foam and memory foam. They come together for better nights and brighter days. Casper's so sure that you're going to love the good night's sleep that you get on a Casper mattress, they're offering you a risk-free trial and return policy. Try sleeping on a Casper mattress for 100 days. That includes free delivery and painless returns. If you don't like it, you can send that mattress back at no extra cost. These are mattresses that are made in America. $500 for a twin-size mattress and $950 for a king-size mattress. Compare that to every other mattress out there, and you'll see that Casper Mattress is the best deal out there for a good night's sleep. Here's a special offer to listeners of my show. You can get $50 off towards any mattress purchase by visiting casper.com/Feldman or by using the promo code Feldman and get $50 towards any mattress purchase. We have questions that people wrote in. I told people.
Really?
Yes. Well, I have a question I want to ask before we get to our listener questions.
Okay.
What was your biggest expense this month?
Biggest expense would probably be my life insurance.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, what did you buy? Because I know...
Nothing. I can't buy anything.
Okay.
Maybe some almonds.
Okay. Okay, here's the question. If nobody knew it was Kevin Meaney underneath the costume, what would you really like to go as this Halloween? That's a good question.
Oh, God.
Do you observe Halloween?
My brother does, because he was born on Halloween. So is my grandfather.
Grandpa I'm Jack.
I'm not a big Halloween fan.
Your Irish grandfather, Jack O'Lantern. Sorry.
My brother's name is Jack.
Is it really?
Yes. And my grandfather's name was Tom, but we would call him Bebop.
Could you do me a favor and do that joke, please?
What joke is that?
Jack O'Lantern. I have an Irish grandfather who was born on Halloween. His name, Grandpa Jack O'Lantern.
Yeah, I'll do that. I'm gonna tweet that.
By the way, what is your Twitter handle? Because you have the best tweets in the world.
At Kevin Meaney. All the kids are going there. Let me go to my last tweet. You know. Oh dear! I lost it. Did I hang up on you?
No.
No. No. Something happened to the web.
Oh, okay. You don't get dressed up on Halloween?
No. And I don't like to do shows on Halloween because there's always the idiot in the, you know, in the audience wearing a mask.
Right.
You know, and they're trying to get the attention and, you know, I'm trying to do a show.
Right. That's why I don't play to burn victims. Sorry.
Oh, like God, but they need to laugh. They really do. They sit there. You just have to accept that.
Your daughter.
You have to old people homes, old age homes, senior facilities. Oh, God, they're the worst. Because there's always somebody in the room that's asleep. And you as a comedian want to go, is that guy dead? And you eventually say it. He could be dead. And they're like, he could be dead. Yeah. He lost someone last night. It's not funny. Yeah. Every day we lose somebody.
You have a daughter. Do you ever go trick-or-treating with her? And if so...
Oh, I used to. Yeah, sure.
Was there ever a Halloween with your daughter that ended unpleasantly?
No. But I do remember one time I got a picture of... Here's not a good costume, Lincoln. You know, the parents go, who do you want to be? I want to be Lincoln. That's not a good thing. You know, you're going to be shot. So, you know, a little 7-year-old kid with the top, you know, with those hats on, you know, you're just looking for trouble. There he is again. Shoot him. Free the slaves. You know, they're still mad.
Yeah, I could see how that could be a problem in certain parts of Boston.
Yeah. Yes. You don't want to do that in Alabama or, you know, down south of the Mason-Dixon line. They don't even sell them, the Lincoln outfits.
And
John Wilkes Booth is very popular down there, though. I'm going to go as Booth. Yeah. I'm trying to do a southern. I'm going as Booth. Yeah. My daddy went as Booth. His daddy went as Booth. My daddy's daddy was Booth.
And finally... Have you been arrested recently? That's the last question. And then I want you to describe the leaves in your backyard.
Oh, God. No, I have not been arrested. And people think that I'm not allowed to fly and that I'm on the no-fly list. And, I've flown millions and millions of miles, maybe 5 million miles in my life, maybe more. I've been arrested twice. So that is, listen... You fly 5 million miles. Let's see how many times you get arrested. You know,
what's the longest you ever were trapped on a plane on the tarmac?
Oh, I got off. I told them to let me out. It was in Minneapolis. No, I was going to Minneapolis, and they landed somewhere else because they had problems, you know, with weather. And I said, they go, we're going to be here for a while. And I said, I have to get off the plane. And I think I feigned illness of some kind. Maybe I collapsed or, you know, I needed medication or I got off the plane. Only one able to get off, rented a car, drove to the gig, got on stage and did the show.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right.
Why companies won't hire me, I don't know. I will be there.
Finally, there is a riot of color right now, and I don't mean Ferguson. I don't know what that meant. But there's a riot of color in your backyard, isn't there?
Yes. Well, it's always like, just say if you came here tonight, you flew in from, where are you now?
I'm in Manhattan.
So you drove up from the city, and you go, oh my God, it's beautiful. It's so beautiful here. Look at the colors, and I would say, well, you know, you should have been here last week. Last week was peak. So you're never there at the right time. You say, no, it's beautiful. Well, last week was peak. You missed the peak. It's like peak is only for like, you know, 2 hours. And then, you know, it's check with the peakers. I'll tell you.
And we're...
Google it. Google peakers. And anybody out there listening, just peakers. P-E-E-K-E-R-S.
And how's your hunting going this year? I know you're a big bear hunter.
I don't hunt. I trap.
Oh, that's right.
So I've got a lot of traps set all out on my land. Just for, mouse traps. You know, not bear traps, right? Little mouse traps. And
then you take the mouse that you've trapped, the mice that you've trapped. You take them down to the general store and you trade the mouse pelts for what?
No, I have them stuffed now. So it's a whole taxidermy thing that I'm getting into. A lot of people don't, they you can stuff a mouse now, and you know, in funny situations, you know, hands up, don't shoot. That's one of them. That's the big seller. You know, I've got a rainbow mouse. So I got a gear. I got a Richard Gear. Of course, I got one of those. Even though it was a gerbil, still they, you know, same family.
Yeah.
So oh, that's doing well.
That gerbil thing is physically impossible.
Okay, let me tell you something. Here, this guy has a lifetime career of great movies. He's a great actor, big star. No matter what you think of him, you know, he's a big star. Mm-hmm. You know. You know, when he dies, God, he had a gerbil up his ass. That's all anybody thinks about. You know, once you get that label, even though he's still working, you know, it's even the guy that hires him, yeah. You know, I wonder if he's ever going to say anything about that.
Right. It's like OJ's problem.
Yeah, same thing. You know, Trump was in Jacksonville this past week, and I was working down there at a club in a mini mall. And we were the only business in the mini mall. Every other business was closed.
As in out of business or just
out of business? Out of business, yeah. But the comedy club survives. No lights in the parking lot. Great, great place. Great venue. I'll send you there. But we, I was with Trump the day OJ was being chased up the 405.
What were you doing?
I was opening up for David Hasselhoff in Atlantic City and at the Trump Castle. And it was his pay-per-view, David Hasselhoff's pay-per-view. And Marla was there. Marla was opening up for David Hasselhoff. Marla Maples, his wife.
Right.
And they sang, "If I were a carpenter and you were my lady, would you marry me anyway? Would you have my baby?" So it was beautiful, and then I went on, and OJ was on TV all day, and then after the show, Donald ordered his people to bring a big TV backstage, and we all sat around and watched OJ being chased and being captured on the 405.
Now, did Donald Trump think that OJ was innocent? Because Donald Trump's a person of color, so they tend to. Hello.
Yeah, I'm here. I sneezed.
Oh, I thought you were like choking on how bad that joke was.
No.
Who's the most famous person you've met? Is Donald Trump up there? I mean, who would be the most intimidating person?
Well, I wasn't intimidated by Donald. I mean, when we were in that little group and we were there for like, you know, at least an hour together, you know, with Marla and David Hasselhoff and the Donald and, you know, a few other people, you know, like maybe two other people. It was just like a small group. Donald was the leader.
Did he let his hair down?
No. He was in charge. It was his, you know, he put this gathering together. But I was kind of like the Joy Behar. And I would lob a bomb in every once in a while. And then Marla would swing her head next to me. Oh, yeah. It's funny. Yeah, twirl her hair.
Could you see being a billionaire and, you know, being friendly with them?
I guess sure. I could be friends with
travel.
Them.
Who's the most powerful, famous person you've either met or performed for?
Well, there's been so many. Kennedy Jr.
Wow.
Yeah. And then I try to introduce my wife to him, and she goes, "No, I can't. I can't get next to him. I can't. So handsome."
Where was this?
This was in L.A.
Wow.
This is at the airport right before he took off. We were flying. I said, "No, I don't want to get on that plane." And gone. Vanished.
Yeah. Was he a funny guy?
No, not really. You know, I kind of assaulted him. You know, I walked into him and I go, "Hey, JJ." "Hey, Junior. Dad, you don't look anything like your father.
You didn't do that.
No, God, no.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Well, let's plug some... This is... Thank you so much for doing this. Let's plug your gigs. Where are you going to be?
I'm going to be in... I guess I'm going to be in Boston on November 14th for the Boston Comedy Festival. I'm going to be in the Borgata in Atlantic City in December. You can get all these dates on my website, kevinmeaney.com. All the kids are going there. I'll be in the Canbar Performing Arts Center on New Year's Eve with a great lineup, Jeff Bolt.
Michael Meehan. In San Francisco.
Yes.
With the Canbar. What is this? I've never heard of this venue.
The Jewish Community Center. You probably would never hear of it, okay?
Well, if I were Jewish, I might have. This would be in San Rafael?
Yes.
In San Rafael?
Yes.
They don't have a Houston Street in San Rafael. So it's the, what is it? So where are you? The Jeff Bolt and Michael Meehan. Have you seen Michael Meehan perform recently?
No.
Well,
but I did his movie, which is out now. I think it's touring the country, you know, at the festivals. Mm-hmm. Take My City, Don't Take My City, something like that. God, I should know the name. I should be a good celebrity and know the names of my movies. Blood Ransom, by the way, you can check that out.
Okay,
I play Mr. Manningham, the head vampire. Yes, go ahead, please.
Let's plug. So once again, I interrupted you on the San Francisco date. What is that again, please?
That would be New Year's Eve.
And that would
and
be
The Canbar Performing Arts Center. Canbar, C-A-N-D-A-R, Canbar Performing Arts Center.
Is that in San Rafael?
San Rafael. Yes.
San Rafael, California.
Yes.
And what are the movies that we can...
Well, I'm going to be on Two Broke Girls on December 10th, which is coming up, CBS, 9:30.
Wow.
Thursday night.
Wow.
Hidden America, which I just taped with Jonah Ray in Boston.
Great.
Blood Ransom. I play Mr. Manningham, head vampire.
What is Blood Ransom?
Blood Ransom is a horror movie. And I play a very serious role. It's not funny. I'm a serious actor. I'm a serious vampire. All the good-looking vampires come to me for advice, and I give it to them, you know?
Is this a role you can really... sink your teeth in. I'm sorry.
Ayo.
Doc,
you must have did a line tonight. Because you are sharp, sharp, sharp.
Well, I love you. You are the funniest man in the world. Jeff Garlin says you're the funniest man in the universe.
Oh, my God.
I
love that, Jeff Garlin.
Yes, and you are. You are. It is an honor to know you.
A handsome man.
Yes.
A very handsome man.
It's an honor to know you, and I hope you come back real soon.
Well, you know, I'm in New York, so maybe you could come up to the house, and I could make you some sweet tea.
Yes.
Maybe some broccoli rabe or something.
Yes, and we've been meaning to... Thank you. I'm going to take you up on that. And maybe next time, if I can figure out how to work this, get Jeremy on the line.
Yes, I know. I saw that... In my history here of the calls with you on Skype, I saw, where you tried to connect us.
And we couldn't make it work.
No.
And I have to call Jeremy. Would you say Jeremy Kramer? What would you say about... how would you describe him?
One of the funniest people I've ever known in my life, you know,
yeah.
So... I can't, you know, I would love to do something with him, you know, like, you know, on film or video, just to capture, you know, whatever that is. He does Periscope now. Do you know that?
No.
Follow him on Periscope, because you'll get a little, you know, ding on your phone, and it'll be Jeremy Kramer is live on Periscope.
Okay.
Then you just see him driving his car. You know, he's got the camera pointed to his face. And I go, hello there, everybody. I'm Jeremy Kramer. You know, and then he looks back out on the road. You know, and he does I'm sitting there in bed like, oh, God, he's just the greatest. He's just so free-spirited.
Are you a consumer of comedy? Do you watch comedy? Do you watch comedy movies? Or
No, I'm a consumer of crime shows. I love crime shows. I mean, I've watched them all. So I don't really watch much stand-up comedy on television because I don't want to be influenced by anybody, you know, like, and then I'll steal a joke or something because right. I'll do that, you know. You know, I'll come see your show, and next thing you know, I'm out on the ships doing it.
Doing the Jack-O-Lantern joke.
Yeah, Jack-O-Lantern. It's funny, funny, funny stuff.
Thank you, sir. Are you there?
David, I'm sorry. I was taking a sip of water.
Oh, thank you so much for doing this. It's an honor, and I'm gonna call Jeremy and get you back real soon.
Are you speaking into a microphone?
Yes.
And you have headphones on?
Yes.
Cans? Do you call them cans?
I call them cans, yes.
I call them cans, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you call it caca or poo-poo?
Caca.
I like caca. Yeah. I think it's not as dirty. It's not as visual. You know, when you say poo-poo, you know, oh, God, that's poo-poo. When you say caca.
Well, caca is the poo-poo that I keep in a mason jar.
Nice.
That's the ones.
I'm having my mom do that now.
Hers or yours?
Hers. You know, so I can. That's just something to keepsake.
Did your mother? You told me your mother used to bronze your caca.
Well, up till a certain age, you know, it wasn't really a bronze thing. It was more of a. You know, she'd cover it with a rice peel off.
What was the proudest you've ever made your mother?
I guess when I would have to say there's been so many times when I gave the commencement address at my old high school. So
wow.
My brother's there and my sister and my mom and dad and my speech, you know, the big speech I gave. You know, to the students of, it was the class of 1994. It was 20 years after I had graduated. And I had mentioned, I just brought up all the things back in the 1974 that you couldn't do that you could do in 1994, you know.
Like threatened to kill your kid.
Yeah, I probably brought that up.
So your mother was proud of you.
She was proud of me when I did my show called Wedding Vows in Vegas. When I did my what happened to me one night in Vegas when I got married to a woman I didn't know, and then I had to get out of it. And she loved that show, loved it. Oh, you, that was the funniest.
You married Britney Spears.
No, I married.
We won't mention.
But she was a great, great gal.
Yes, and.
I tried to carry her over the threshold. No, we had a great time for that time.
And did your father, what was the proudest you ever made your father?
Oh.
This is where I make my guests cry.
Cry, yeah. Oh, there's been so many times that I made him proud. You know, when I graduated 174 out of 175 in my class in high school. One kid had died, so I'd gone down a rank.
Are you saying you were at the bottom of the class?
Yes, I was at the bottom of the class, yeah. No, he was proud of me for...
Did you really graduate?
I did. Yes, I did. I didn't try.
That's almost as poorly as I did in the San Francisco comedy competition.
But he liked, you know, he came to see all my plays. And he liked what I did on stage and encouraged me to, you know, follow my dream. So he, you know, was very supportive and, you know, me doing what I wanted to do, you know, where my mother was like, no, you have to get a job. You have no benefits. And my dad would send me, when I was living in San Francisco, when I first met you, I would get a letter from my dad, and he would have like $10 in, you know, the envelope, or $20. Oh. You know, and he goes, you know, make sure you get whatever you need, you know. So that was a lot of money, you know, back then, you know.
And was he okay with Cab Calloway living next door?
I wasn't okay with Cab Calloway. I had the problem with him. And I learned a very valuable business lesson. When it was a big snowstorm, I went across the street. I knocked on his door and I said, do you want your driveway shoveled? He said, yes. I shoveled it. Then I went up to the door and I went to get my money, and he gave me like a dollar. And I was like, you know, that was like a $4 or $5 job. You know, and I still carry that with me, that he cheated me. But I cheated myself, because I should have said, listen, I will shovel your driveway for $10. Then he could have negotiated it down to $5. I said, okay, I'll do it.
Do you think Cab Calloway is cheap? Like, is that a stereotype about Asian people that he...
He's not Asian.
His name is Cab. Isn't he yellow?
No, he's African-American.
Well, why is he called Cab? Cabs are yellow.
Because that's his nickname. Because he would never take the bus. He would always take a cab.
Which is ironic for a black man.
To the gigs. He would always do the gig. But he said to me one time, we were at Billy Boyle's house across the street from the Calloways, and Cab was visiting Mr. and Mrs. Boyle, and Billy and I walked into the house, and he was talking about the Blues Brothers, and he said, yeah, that Dan Aykroyd, he's a smart, smart man. But that John Belushi, oh, God, he's an idiot. That's what he said. Hey, listen, don't shoot the messenger. All right. He did not like John Belushi. He did not like him.
How long did Cab live near you?
Oh, my God, my whole life. You know, we moved to the house, he was there. But nobody ever said there was a black person in the neighborhood until a black person moved into the neighborhood. And then I was always confused. And my mother would say, you know, there, it was a big news that we lived in Mayfair Acres and a black family moved into the neighborhood. And my mother's, be nice, be nice. And I couldn't understand. I said, like, you know, what's the big deal of a black person moving into the neighborhood? Meanwhile, we got Cab Calloway across the street.
But he wasn't considered black.
No, he was a celebrity.
I see.
Yeah. Isn't that weird?
Yeah. And now who lives in that house? Uber Calloway?
No, that house was, well.
Uber?
The family that had moved into the neighborhood, you know, not the Calloways, the new black family, that house was burned down. So that's gone, and there's a still fenced up crime scene.
Seriously?
No. You know who else lived down the street? This is what you won't believe this. Mom's Mabley.
Wow.
Yes.
Did you know Mom's Mabley?
No, but my father would drive by the house all the time and said, "There's where Mom's lives." And it was the nicest house. It was always so well kept. You know, she was very neat, Mom's.
Did you see the documentary that Whoopi did on Mom's?
Yeah, that was great.
She was absolutely brilliant.
Whoopi played Mom's, didn't she?
That's right.
Yeah.
On Broadway.
Yeah, on Broadway.
Yeah. Wow, so you grew up with royalty.
Babe Ruth is buried right up the street. In Gate of Heaven. Judy Garland interned at the Gate of Heaven. A lot of big celebs. The Jimmy Cagney. You know, I lived right near a cemetery, so we were never afraid of death.
Wow. Do you remember Judy Garland's internment?
Sure. We broke into all the graves.
No, I'm talking about when she was rounded up as a Japanese American during World War II.
She was.
For her internment for 2 years. Don't you remember? They thought she was Japanese.
Oh.
You don't remember that?
No, I don't remember that.
So do you remember the big funeral?
A lot of funerals would come by our house, and we would sit out, you know, on the stump and watch the cars go by. It was kind of sad. but fun. We would count them. You know, we'd say, okay, there, that's a big celeb. There was like 40 cars.
And finally, what did you make for dinner tonight?
Well, I'm making it now. I have a nice piece of cod. I have some spinach and onions and garlic, and that's it.
And then what are you going to do?
I am going to take a sponge bath, as I do every night. I'm going to maybe get in my gravity boots for about a half an hour. And then, you know, go into lockdown.
Are you going to read?
No, I'm going to be on the internet, and I'm going to go on, I'm going to turn on the TV, and I'm going to watch something on Netflix.
What are you going to watch?
Maybe The Aviator.
That's a, yeah.
With, it's about Howard Hughes.
Yeah, yeah. That's a, it's a great movie.
I hear it's great.
Yeah, it's fun. He had an amazing life.
Mm, God, no. Before I watch it, I'll wash my hands. Scrub myself, give myself a Silkwood shower. I guess him and... God, he was an interesting man. I really liked him a lot. Howard Hughes. Fascinated with him.
Yeah. And what is that? Is that meat? Is that... What is that crunching sound?
That is my collar, you know, going up against my, or it could be my beard. I'm just opening up the oven now. I'm just, because I'm going to put my fish in there. How do you like that?
All right.
Nice. And it's wild caught cod. You know, this isn't like just any cod. This is like a guy out there in a boat. He catches it. Can you hear that?
Like, yep.
Right in the oven. Yep. There we go.
Great.
Let's see. It's going to be done. All right. 8 o'clock. It's 5 o'clock your time. Okay. I think I'm going to cook it on Pacific time. Because it's Alaskan.
Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you, David.
We have a new sponsor today, Casper Mattress. You can purchase a Casper mattress at casper.com/Feldman or by using the promo code Feldman. That's our show. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, go to kevinmeaney.com. And please help us out by going to davidfeldmanshow.com and hit the Amazon banner and do all your shopping via the David Feldman Show from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. I'm David Feldman.